All right, boxing fans, we're back, and we're going to try this again. We're live on air, the Boxing Voice TV. I'm joined alongside, as always, Jackie, the Boxing Diva. Jackie, how's it going today?
Good. Good. We're good. We're getting over the snowstorm and relaxing. Just cooked some dinner. Ready to talk some boxing.
So you got a lot of memorabilia back there.
Yes, yes. That's the Ward Gotti wall. You can't see, but below it is actually a painting that two artists from England did of the trilogy, and it's signed by Mickey and Dickie, personalized to me. Just some of the stuff that we have. I think, as you know, we have a ton of stuff, and I just got a new piece today, so always collecting.
Very good, very good. So, you know, today, again, we're going to attempt to have Steve Cunningham, USS Cunningham, back on the show. We're going to attempt to interview him and, you know, see exactly what's going on in his mind and what happened as far as the actual decision that took place versus the Ademic fight anyway. And hopefully we could get this done. I really want to get this show on the road in terms of doing this thing right. It's, you know, clearly very important to me, and I want to get it right, basically. So, I don't know. Hopefully that works. But, you know, I had the opportunity to watch the Broner fight again this week.
I watched it, too.
Yeah, man, I love that kid. You know, he's definitely great for boxing. He has a really unique style that it's really fan pleasing for myself. I'm, you know, I'm definitely enjoying this the whole Broner hype train, if you want to call it that. I know Matt Up on Twitter, and that's Matt Up, two T's. He definitely calls it that. You know, I think that he's the real deal, man. And just after watching him do what he did, the way that he did, I'm completely sold and ready to see more. Unfortunately, he's going to be facing Gavin Reeves. We should be having on at a little later our Scotland correspondent, who is definitely, you know, in touch with Gavin Reeves a lot and speaks to him. And we'll see what he has to say in terms of that and, you know, just to see what's on Gavin's mind as far as, you know, facing Broner and what he can possibly bring to the table.
Yeah, I think anybody facing Broner is up for, you know, a challenge. I do agree that he's probably one of the more talented prospects out there right now. He's probably a contender at this point, not a prospect anymore. Personally, I don't like him. He was rude to us personally, or to me at least. So that actually puts a little damper on it, but I do agree. He's good for boxing. He gets people interested. People want to see who he's going to bring to the ring with him and what he's going to wear. Kind of like the early Mayweather. So, good for boxing, yes. A good boxer, definitely. Not my favorite.
I hear you, man. I hear you. And then, you know, the thing is, there's a lot of people that, you know, feel that way as far as his attitude. It reminds them of Mayweather, his arrogance, his brashfulness. But at the end of the day, a lot of people put to the side all the antics that Mayweather brings to the ring. And, you know, I think they need to do that with Broner because, you know, he's entertaining, man. He's entertaining. I you know, just watching him do what he did to DeMarco again, DeMarco really couldn't hit him, and he was standing in front of him. It was just such brilliance to me. I mean, how was the way he picks his shots off, and you know, really the right word to use is he parries the shots as they're coming in. He does use the forearm and the elbow a bit. Maybe in the future they'll call him on that, but I guess until they do, I mean, he's going to continue to do it.
Yeah, but I don't think it's really anything too dirty, like, say, Victor Chinian dirty. We all know he's, you know, notorious for being a dirty fighter. But, like I said, I think he's only going to get better. The DeMarco fight, I thought, was really kind of a genius. Like you said, he picks his shots, and he's very intelligent. He's a smart boxer. And you got to respect that. Rude or not, you got to respect it.
Absolutely, you do. You know, unfortunately, he's going to start off the February, the new year in February, like I said, versus an opponent that, you know, I personally really don't give him much of a shot. Again, if John Campbell makes it on, he could give us more info on that since he's over there in the UK. But I just want to see him versus, you know, better opposition to truly see how good he is, because again, the DeMarco performance was his best performance. While the Jason Litzau performance was something, you know, beautiful.
Who is Jason Litzau?
Well, I wouldn't go as far as that.
In terms of calling somebody a genius against Jason Litzau.
No, well, I get you. I mean, I just feel that the best of Broner is going to come out when he's fighting a good fighter. Clearly, that's always been the thing, always been the case. Like, you know, as the better performances come out when a fighter's forced to test himself and push himself to that limit, and then you get that great performance out of him. So, you know, I just want to see him in there with stiffer competition so that, you know, we can possibly continue to see how great he is.
I agree. I'm totally with you on that. I do think that, I mean, we've all heard talks of a Gamboa fight with him. And personally, I think that would be the real proving ground for him. Because Gamboa is a very skillful boxer, and he's, even though surprisingly he went down in his last fight, I don't think people should start counting him out yet. He has promotional issues, and layoffs might affect him in the future, but I think that's something I'd like to see how great Broner could be, because we know he's good. How great can he be?
No, absolutely. I totally agree. I had the opportunity as well to watch the Andre Ward. You know, HBO. Yes, and Chad Dawson. You know, HBO has been showing their best of 2012, and you know, it was good, and it was a great performance by Dawson. By Ward to see him, and it just says the John McDonald. There he goes. Let me see. I see John's coming on. He's coming on a little slow. That's his screenshot. So clearly he's not all set up yet. John, do you hear us?
There he is.
John, can you hear us?
We can't hear you.
We can't hear you. So you might want to go into the microphone on the right, the settings buttons on the top right, and just make sure that your settings are set to default maybe.
Yeah, default device.
Yeah, default device.
You're not using an external device.
Yeah, so Andre Ward, he did something that I guess can be considered brilliant as well. I mean, he faced a bigger man. He faced a guy where the fight wasn't necessarily favored for him to win. Maybe he was supposed to win as far as on the betting line, but, you know, any fight fan knows that it wasn't probably a 50-50 fight, because we've all known Dawson to have some sort of mental problems. You know, he showed that in the Pascal fight. Mm-hmm. But it was definitely a good fight. It wasn't like, an Andre Ward, Edison Miranda, where Ward was this huge favorite. I mean, there was possibilities that Dawson brought into the ring, certain attributes that he has that were supposed to present a problem for Andre Ward. You know, height, reach, experience for that matter. Dawson has been fighting on the elite level in his division for a very long time. So it was just good to see these new guys, these new faces of boxing come into the sport and pretty much, you know, show their brilliance.
I totally agree with you. I do believe that Andre Ward is the new face of boxing. You know, as we all know, Floyd's, what, 43 now? And while he's still technically sound, I just think that Andre Ward's going to be the next best thing. aside from obviously Broner being tagged as the next Mayweather, but that's a different conversation for a different day. As far as the Chad Dawson performance, I agree with you, it was brilliant. He picked him apart, he fought the right fight. It was just, we watched it last night, and it was just genius.
Joe, you got to turn your speakers down or something. All right. Jackie, I think you could go ahead now.
Well, yeah, just what I was saying. We watched it last night and all 12 rounds. And the first time, I don't remember, like, sitting down and watching it like that. So I really kind of tried to really observe what was going on. And it was just, like you said, he fought a bigger guy and he didn't really have to. And the one who was supposed to win.
Joe, you got to do something with your settings, buddy. You're getting feedback. All right, so I muted Joe until he can figure that out. John, can we hear you now? You want to try speaking? Yeah, I'm still not hearing you, buddy. Still not hearing you. You also have to fix your settings on your I guess your computer and things like that.
I look really bloated today.
Yeah. Okay. So we got about 7 minutes.
I'm always in top diva form, and today is one of those days. Sorry.
John, I don't know if you can hear me, but all laptops should come with a built-in mic. So, again, you just want to go to the settings and click default devices whatever that thing is. Talking here, the best of boxing for 2012, we're talking what HBO has been putting out for us. What's tonight's fight? Are they putting one tonight, or are they waiting for...
You know, I'm really not sure. I really don't know. We can check. Let's find out. Give me one second.
Okay. So anyway, we should be having Steve Cunningham coming on in about 6 minutes. By then, hopefully, Joe Habib has, fixed his... his microphone and we can hear. I'm going to try you now, Joe. Are you ready? Are you there? Joe? Hello?
You just muted him again.
All right. What about now, Joe?
Nope.
Joe. Well, we're definitely...
Maybe he'll talk if you ask him to sing for us again.
Well, he can definitely hear us clearly. Hear you now. Now you're good. So what was going on? Were you running two computers at once?
I think I had two windows open. I apologize. I didn't realize it.
Okay. So, yeah, we were just talking the two fights that they aired, Best of Boxing, which was Andre Ward versus Chad Dawson and Adrian Broner versus DeMarco. And we were just speaking how DeMarco just showed his brilliance. Broner showed his brilliance versus DeMarco, and how it's kind of sad that he's going to be facing, Gavin Reeves next, which is an opponent that he's basically pegged to win. Like, it's not really going to be much of a fight. I mean, let's be honest.
Well, it's not his fault. I mean, it looks like he's going to have to move to 140 to get competition. Brandon Rios, that's a great fight for him. Marquez is another great fight for him. But this is what we're left with. I mean, we have no choice. He has no choice. He's got to stay active. He's got to get the fights to, keep honing his craft. He can't be on the shelf like a lot of other fighters because he's in the prime of his career, and he's got to make money, and he's got to stay sharp. So he's got to take these types of fights. He's left with nothing else.
Yeah, I mean, it's understandable, but, you have to be let down that things turned out this way,
Absolutely.
It would have just been a lot better for him to be in there with a better opponent. I mean, I read the article that he did with FightHype.com, and, you know, he mentioned that if he beats Vasquez, you know, he's not going to get much credit for it because we all know that he's better than him. And basically everyone in that division, like the only fight he wants at 135 is with Ricky Burns, and if he can't get Burns, he wants to move up to 140. And that's understandable as well. But, I mean, guys like Vasquez and Ricky Burns and you know, I don't know who else is in that division. I guess at this point, Gesta doesn't deserve a crack at him. But there's other names in that division that he can at least focus his attention on, don't you think?
Well, I wouldn't have minded seeing a Vasquez fight. I mean, it would have been a unification fight. And I still think that Vasquez would have posed a challenge for him because of his style. And also, I think it would have been a tougher fight than this Ruiz fight. So, yeah, I mean, I agree that this fight's not the greatest fight, and I think the Vasquez fight would have been a better option, in my opinion.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. I would have liked to see him in there with a better challenge. I mean, he's already rated number one in the division. You know, he mentioned Richard Abril, and, you know, he said that it would be an easy fight. I guess Sharif Bogari, or Bogare, as they pronounce it, is also a fight that I wouldn't mind watching. Kevin Mitchell was a guy that lost to Ricky Burns, and then you got Beltran and John Mary, and that's your top 10 in that division. So, you know, John, are you live with us? Can we hear you now?
I don't know. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. It would have been better if you would have been hardwired into your system there so that, you know, everyone could hear you. But you're more familiar with Gavin Reeves. You want to give the world, I guess, your take on what his possibilities of winning this fight is going to be versus Adrian Broner. Yeah. John, it's not working. Won't you disconnect, connect into your Ethernet? You're probably on Wi-Fi or something, or are you straight in? You're hardwired in or what?
I'm on Wi-Fi.
Yeah, try not using Wi-Fi because I guess because you're all the way overseas, it's coming in very choppy and your words aren't, able to come clear. Jackie, go ahead and check on Cunningham. We got 1 minute for him. The invite is sent. I'm going to resend another one. And hopefully we could get this interview going. So, Beeb. All right, finally, yes, the camera's working now with the volume. I don't know, I was having a bit of trouble with that as well. I don't know, man. We're coming into the new year in about, let me see, today's what, the 30th? Yep. In about 4 days. We're going to have a fight down in Miami. We're going to have the return of Jonathan Gonzalez. And we're also going to see Rancis Bartholomew in the ring, undefeated fighter. I think he's 17 with 12 KOs. Interesting to see Jonathan Gonzalez. He's up with a pretty good test. I mean, he's going to be facing Derek Ennis, who's a tested vet, man. He's been in there with big names. So it's interesting to see what Mr. Jonathan Gonzalez is going to be able to do with Derek Ennis. What's your opinion?
Definitely not a soft touch at all, but, you know, Ennis definitely is a little crafty. He's going to be a little difficult for Gonzalez to decipher. I mean, if you really look at it, it's a tough fight. It's a very tough fight. It's not a gimme. You know, people can criticize Gonzalez for his work ethic in terms of trying to make weight, but he's a very confident individual. I mean, he's not afraid to get in there with anybody. I mean, he was in there with Zurich, and this fight is not a cakewalk at all. So I just think that this is a fight where he's going to, again, have to impose his will. He's going to have to stay busy. He's going to have to keep moving forward. He can't allow Ennis the room to be able to squeeze off his punches and be able to counterpunch, because Ennis is a quick guy in his own right. So if Ennis is allowed to move around, he's allowed to flurry with his combinations and get out of there, he can have success. Whereas if Gonzalez can cut the ring off, pin him in a corner, trap him, wear him down, tire him out, he can impose his will upon Ennis. So this is a very, very interesting matchup.
I totally agree with Joe. I've seen Derek Ennis a number of times. He's a Philly kid. I fought Gabe Rosado in Bally's in Atlantic City, I think it was, and maybe it might have been Philly, not quite sure, but he's crafty, and he can get in there, so I think Gonzalez is going to have to be on his A game, and like Joe said, get the first punch off, not get countered, because he can counter punch. Like, most Philly fighters are pretty, you know, are good counter punchers.
They're savvy, the Philly fighters, definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, he's promising a knockout, and he's also saying that he's on weight. I mean, we've heard this before, Beeb. Should we believe him? But he's saying that he's on weight. He's saying he's ready. But again, we heard this with the whole, what was the fight? The Zirinzarik fight. Yeah. He said he was going to be on weight, and he said he was on weight. And then, you know, come fight night, sure enough, he wasn't on weight, or come the weigh-in, rather, for that matter. He wasn't on weight. So, I don't know. Should we take it on, take his word for it?
Well, given his past history, it's hard to not doubt him. But, I mean, I'm going to give him one more benefit of the doubt, because I really like the kid. I like the way he approaches the fights. I think he's a very aggressive guy. He stays busy. Even despite the weight issues, he's still in pretty good shape. You know what I'm saying? He has a very high work rate in there. He doesn't seem to be getting tired when he's in there. So, you got to give him credit for that. I mean, he seems to be a hard worker in terms of honing his skills and bringing a lot to the table come fight night. But, you know, to his defense, he is a big guy. It wouldn't hurt him to possibly move up to 160. You know, 154 may be too small for him.
Yeah.
That's something you're going to have to look at in the future, because he's a thickly built guy. You know, he's a thickly built guy. And if I was in his circle of advisors, I would recommend possibly moving up to 160, because, again, he could further utilize his size and his strength, and he would probably be an even better fighter at 160 than he is at 154, in my opinion.
Yeah, you know, when we had him on the show and we interviewed him, he said he didn't want to move up. He said that he can make the weight. I don't know if it's because he feels that, you know, he knew he was slacking, and maybe if he felt like he gave it his all, it would work for him. I'm not 100% sure as to why his reason was that he, you know, felt like he didn't need to move up. But I believe he came in somewhere around 169 fight night.
Yeah. I mean,
that's heavy. That's heavy.
I suspect he's probably walking around at close to 175, maybe even 180, to try to get down to 154. That's a stretch. I mean, that's just a stretch. He's a young kid. He's still growing, and I just don't know how long it'll be physically possible for him to fight at 154 while maintaining his health. It's going to become dangerous at some point. We've seen Rios try to struggle to make 135, and these guys, they get this false sense of security, whereas, okay, I'm going to peel down to 154, or I'm going to peel down to the weight limit, and then come fight that, I'm just going to balloon up and be so much bigger than my opponent, it's going to be my advantage. But I see it a different way. I think it's a disadvantage, because you're punishing your body throughout the course of a training camp, and it's more or less becoming a weight camp as opposed to, you know, working on the boxing. So if that's the case, which I may suspect it could be, then that's not good for a young fighter. It's definitely not good for Gonzalez in this situation here, in my opinion.
So, John, we got you back. Let's do another test run. Could we hear you now?
I can hear me, my bad.
Whoa. So, yeah, we can hear you, but it sounds like somebody's got your computer in a chokehold. and you connected to Ethernet? Yeah, man, it sounds horrible. We can't even make out any words. We're just hearing sounds at this point. I don't think it's because of the mic. I'm hoping. I'm assuming you said you think it's because of the mic, but it doesn't sound like the mic. It just sounds like bad internet at this point. But Jackie, I'm gonna send it to both, because, like I said, the one without the picture is Steven, so I'm gonna send it to Steve as well.
Okay.
And see what happens here.
And try it by email, like I like I said in the chat, because that usually...
I don't know how to do that.
When it, on this side, it says invite people, and you can just type in that email address and hit send.
On which side?
Like when you hit invite people on top?
Yeah.
And then it says name or email? Type in the email instead of just the name.
All right, I'll try that.
That's how we did it when we were doing our test runs.
All right, I will give that a shot. So, Beeb,
did you catch? I'm representing you today.
Oh, it's a beautiful cup.
Isn't it?
Beantown, baby. you know what it is.
Holla.
Beeb, did you catch the replay of the DeMarco versus Broner?
I actually did not, but I do remember the fight very well. And, again, even though Broner was a prohibitive favorite in that fight, he still fought a very excellent fight. I mean, he just dissected poor DeMarco in that fight. And you almost had to feel bad for DeMarco. He got beat so bad. Because I was one of the few that thought that was going to be somewhat competitive while it lasted. And I was way off on that one. People called me crazy before, and then after the fight, they were ready to bring in the straitjackets because I was way off on my prediction before the fight. I thought it was going to be a competitive fight to some degree because I, you know, regardless of, you know, DeMarco's skill level, he's still a dogged, determined guy, and he gives you a tough out, you know, as long as he's in there. He doesn't always finish the fight. You know, we saw in the Valero fight, you know, obviously he was stopped in that fight as well, but he still had his moments in that fight. Where, you know, he was tagging Valero a little bit. In this fight, he lost every second of every round up until the point he got stopped. So, you know, you got to give Broner credit. I mean, he fought this fight in the phone booth, basically fought DeMarco's fight to some degree at close range, and he was able to squeeze off really short uppercuts and hooks on the inside, and he manhandled DeMarco, which was something that I just didn't expect.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with you. I was just more curious as to, you know, if you watched it again and to get your overall opinion after witnessing that, I don't know, just watching it again, because it gave me something. It gave me an opportunity, because this I think would make now my fourth time. I watched it live while covering the fight at Press Row, and I came back home immediately and watched it. And I watched it about another time, but then last night, I think it was last night, is when I watched it again, and I was just able to see how much he didn't get hit, how well his defense was, how aggressive he was when he wanted to be, like when he felt like turning it on. And the advice also that Coach Mike Stafford was giving him, Stafford didn't want him to take any breaks. He didn't want him to get off the gas. He wanted him to get this guy out of here as soon as possible.
Well, very few fighters, when they do move to the inside, are able to make themselves a compact target. I mean, Andre Ward's able to do it. Bernard Hopkins is able to do it. And that's where the savviness and the skill comes in. Guys tend to square up when they get on the inside. Broner, you know, made himself, you know, a very hard target, gave, you know, kind of angled his body a little bit, didn't square up, gave you that small silhouette to throw punches at, and dipped his head over to the side when he was throwing the hook. And just basically his upper body was almost as if it was on a swivel, even at close range. And he was just terribly hard for DeMarco to hit, because he just didn't have much to shoot at or throw at. So that's just a skill that not many fighters have, and it's really a gift, if you will.
Yeah, absolutely. That's why I'm so excited. I really wish that John could speak, because I know that he's already spoke to Gavin Reeves. So I'm interested to see what's Gavin's thoughts. I mean, I know there's not going to be any fighter that's going to come on and say, hey, no, you know, I know I'm going to lose. But I want to see what he feels he can take advantage, what he has seen as a fighter that he feels, all right, well, there's a – mistake that he makes that I can capitalize on if given the opportunity.
Well, a lot of fighters, when they fight guys like Broner, Floyd Mayweather, that type of style where they're not particularly high-volume guys, where they're more precise punchers. They make every shot count. A lot of times, people tend to think that they can go in there, put the pressure on, and outwork them. But again, when you do that or try to do that, you leave yourself open, and that's where these guys are able to excel and take advantage of your mistakes. So you have to be precise yourself. You just can't go in there thinking you're going to throw a blanket over these guys and smother them with punches, because you're going to get stuff back in return. And the one thing about Broner is he's a hard hitter. I mean, he hits these guys, and they're stopping, freezing in their tracks. And, you know, we saw the effect of his punches that, you know, that they had on DeMarco. And that was very surprising that he was able to basically hurt DeMarco every time he put hands on him. I mean, I just didn't expect that. DeMarco being the tough young Mexican, I thought he'd be able to handle some of these shots, walk through some of these shots, and make the fight more interesting. But that just wasn't the case because of Broner's power. I mean, you could argue that Broner, you know, does have a similar style to Mayweather, but the one difference, and I know you've said this yourself, is the power. And he does actually throw a little bit more combinations than Mayweather. He does, when he does land that one shot, he'll follow with two or three more. So he does put his shots together very nice, and he's not afraid to open up. And he did open up in this fight against DeMarco. He did throw more punches than I thought he would. He did put shots together, and he threw combinations. It wasn't just as though he was trying to pot shot. He was putting shots together, and he was being aggressive, and he was coming forward.
Absolutely. You know, I wanted to get your arch nemesis on today, but he has to. Oh, all right. I think we got our.
There we go.
Woo!
Finally. All right.
I got my scarf out. I'm ready.
All right. So, Jackie, won't you start so that I can let everybody know on the social media world that we finally got Steve live here. So you and Beeb, go ahead and take over the interview, okay?
Okie dokie. I think we can start off pretty simple with, like, how are you feeling, and are you it's hard to get over, but how are you dealing with the decision a week and a half, 2 weeks later? It was awful, so we all know it was awful, but why don't you just give us your rundown?
I'm you know, time has helped me, has helped ease my pain a bit. Can y'all hear me good?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Perfect.
Cool. I just finally watched the fight last night, you know, for the first time. I just was like, I was so angry at the decision. I after the fight, you see me immediately raise my hands. I felt it was a unanimous decision. So even when they said draw, that was disappointing to me. I'm like, what? But I was disgusted. I'm still disgusted, but it's one of them things, man. You know, is what can you do? You know, I've talked with my lawyer, and I've talked with the commissioner of Pennsylvania, and there's not too much we can do outside of petition for a rematch. And it's like, do I want that? You know what I'm saying? I already beat him. I set out to do what I did, you know, what I wanted to do, and I did it. And, you know, if that's the only thing I can get, I'll take it. But, I mean, I'm ready to move on, you know, disappointedly move on.
Right. So you would take a rematch? You would go in there and do it again?
Well, yeah, of course I would. I mean, with the first fight being what it was, and with this second fight being, from what we heard, the ratings were great. I can't really speak on that, but, you know, hopefully there's money for the third fight. If, you know, just like Adamick said, if the money's right. Of course he say that, if the money's right.
Right.
I took this fight. I mean, it wasn't a lot of money, but, you know, I thank NBC for and Main Events for all that they did, but, you know, people think this wasn't a lot of money. It was opportunity. It was one of those opportunity fights. And we spent some of our own money to go down to New Orleans, deal with Mackie Shieldstone. He hooked us up with some good stuff. Dealt with MHP. I mean, we're going here and there. We're spending our money because we had faith in, you know, we were going to beat this dude. And it was going to pay off. Now, judges had another idea, you know.
Did you lose some of your faith in boxing?
You can say, yeah, a little. I mean, not a lot, because we've seen this happen already numerous times. And the problem is, you know, this is the thing. What needs to be done to correct it? Because it's happened numerous times, and it's going to continue to happen. It's like these judges aren't being held accountable. I mean, let's just go solely off of the 10th round in my second fight with Adamick.
Mm-hmm.
That was a clear round for me. I mean, unbelievably clear round for me. How could those two judges give him the fight, you know, give him that round? I mean, it's either they're on the take or they're just imbeciles. You know, they're just incompetent. They don't know how to judge. And If they're incompetent, what's being done to ensure that judges are getting what they need to know on what how to really score a fight? It seems the only way to score a fight is if the guy fights the last 10 seconds of the round and scores a couple shots or presses, then he wins the fight. That's ridiculous. I'm winning the fight. I'm controlling the round for 2 minutes and 40 seconds, and he presses even more, still unsuccessful, but that wins him a round. That's bogus.
And that was going to be my next question because I was live, and I spoke to you after the fight, as you know, but that's what he was doing. He was stealing rounds, as it's called, and it seems like there's an education problem among judges.
Yeah.
And it's just, it's awful, but you fought a good fight. Was that your game plan to fight the fight you fought, did it follow your game plan, I guess, question?
Yeah, yep, that was the game plan. I mean, you know, I've got a great trainer in Brother Nazim. I think he's the best trainer in the world for me. You know, some probably won't say that, but he's brought something out of me that I didn't even know was there. And he's the best trainer for me. Our game plan was from day one. And I tell you this, one thing about Brother Nazim. For the first fight, you know, I should have been working with Nazim for that first Atomic fight. But, you know, he had the stroke before that, and I got my other trainer, and that's what happened. But he felt kind of guilty over all these years and you know, for not being there. You know, you can see it on his face when he talks, and especially in training camp for this fight. You can see it on his face. You can see the urgency to pay attention to detail. You know, Steve, you got to listen, man. You can do it. You got to do this. It was just like he was talking to one of his sons. You know what I'm saying? How you would talk to your son about being so sharp. And I took that, and I'm like, wow. It's like I have a great team. I keep saying that. You know, everybody cares about me. We care about each other. And you can just see his passion to win this fight. So the game plan was to outbox this man. Everybody tries to get in there and slug with Adamic. They try to punch with him. And you know, they try to go toe-to-toe with him and knock him out because he is hittable. So, and that's what I told Walker after the fight. I told Travis, I said, man, he's so easy to hit, but you get sucked in, you know, into going toe-to-toe with him and try to knock him out, and he'll get you. So our game plan was the box, just like Eddie Chambers. And you see Eddie Chambers used movement, boxing, and speed with right. one arm. So, you know, that was the game plan, to outbox him, and we did it, you know. I feel we did it.
We have a question here in the chat. John McDonald, who's down here on the bottom, but his microphone's having issues, so I'll go ahead and ask it for him. What did you make of Adamek's press release saying that you ran the whole fight?
I mean, that's the sounds of a guy who got beat, of a guy who can't say anything else other than try to make the people's opinion be what he wants it to be. Like I told him at the press conference, I did the same thing you did to Chris Areola. You know, I did that to you. And when you see the Chris Areola fight versus Tomas Adamek, he boxed. He used the ring. He used speed because he was faster than Areola, and he used movement in and out. That's what I did, you know. And I did it smarter. It's just, you know, Roger Bloodworth and Adamek, the team Adamek, they've been pulling the wool over America's, over the world's eyes since he became a heavyweight. Oh, he's so fast. His head movement, he's got an American boxing style now. It's like, yeah, right. Just because Bloodworth told him to drop his left hand and move to an angle, that's American style, that's boxing. Adamic's a puncher. That's all he is, that's all he will be. You know, and that's his only chance. Once you take the punching away by boxing, you see what happens.
Exactly. We're going to get to what's next for you later, but what do you think is available out there for Adamek now that people see that kind of, no matter what happens, he's going to, it seems like, no matter who he fights, he's going to get the decision unless he gets knocked out. Where do you think he can go in the heavyweight division?
Well, I mean, he's going to, and this is what pisses me off, you know, he's going to go to Germany and fight Pulev in his tournament, probably make $200,000 or more, and, you know, that should have been me, you know, but it's like, people are saying, well, there's no losers in this fight. Yeah, right, there is a loser. That's me, you know. I got the loss on my record, you know, but they're saying my performance was this good and that good. It shouldn't hurt me financially. A lot of people don't realize Steve Cunningham isn't one of those upper echelon fighters. I am a two-time world champ, but I'm not the guy who can fight for $1 million this fight and the next fight I'm still making that type of money. You know, that's just right. Not us, you know. So I need every win I can get. And but with Adamek fighting Pulev's got a decent jab. He's strong. He's big. I think Pulev may do some things to Adamek. You know, if not, he fights Vladimir, if Adamant gets past Pulev and fights Vladimir, it may be worse than when he fought Vitaly. You know?
Right. We're going to pass it off to Nestor now, and then we'll continue.
Steve, man, thanks again for coming on. I know that everybody's been waiting for you. There's someone has an echo. John, is that you?
John has his speakers on.
Who?
John has his speakers on. There you go.
Yeah, it was John. Sorry, John. It is you. All right, so Steve, we're really grateful that you took the opportunity to come back on and basically, you know, go over everything that you're feeling. I know another question to John in our chat, and unfortunately his mic is down. It would have been a lot better for him to be giving you these questions himself, but he wants to know, do you feel that this decision is a worse one than the Warcraft fight?
Oh, the Lodarczyk fight in Poland? I think so, yeah. I think the Lodarczyk fight, I mean, they both got that little sting to them, because the Shistov-Lodarczyk fight in Poland was my first loss. You know, I was undefeated at the time, and that was like, wow, this is unbelievable. You know, I beat this guy. You know, this is unbelievable. The one judge had me winning 11 rounds to one, losing one, and the other two, which were Polish and German, of course, had me losing the majority of the rounds. So I'm like, that hurt. But this one hurt even more because, you know, it was, I'm not going to say revenge. It was just letting people know I can beat this guy. I just made mistakes last time. It was one of them things, and you get a chance. It's very seldom you get a chance to right some wrongs, you know. You talk about, like, an old girlfriend you had, and you messed up. And you're like, man, if I didn't do that, we'd still be together, you know. So it was sort of like that, you know. I saw the wrongs that I made in the first fight, and we corrected them. And then even came in with an even better game plan. And to not get that decision, doing things that I've seen other fighters do and win fights, you know, I mean, it's just these judges, man. It boils down to incompetence, man.
Yeah, and I agree with you, because I want to take you into that fight. I mean, Jackie touched on it a little bit, but he wouldn't even come on the last 15 seconds. It would really be when he heard that 10-second bell.
Yeah.
And then he would flurry, but a lot of those flurries, I've watched the fight about four times. I've scored it, and I'm going to go over my score, because I do have it a little closer than most, but I still have you ahead. Even if you lost the last round, you would have been ahead. So I really don't understand what happened. But in those flurries, a lot of those punches weren't hitting you. Do you think that even us who watched it on television, or the judges that watched it live, truly couldn't see that those combinations weren't landing those last 10 seconds of each round?
I think it's just the whole thing with, you know, like a lot of people say, aggression. He's moving, you know, he's coming towards you. That doesn't automatically score you a round, you know. That doesn't automatically score you a win. I mean, what else can Adamic do but walk forward? He's 223-24 pounds. You know, what else can he do? He's sluggish. He shouldn't even be that big. He's sluggish. He's slower, you know, than me. He can't do anything but walk forward. I was 203 pounds, and, you know, I moved, I boxed, and I think the judges, if they can't see, they need higher chairs, you know?
That's a perfect segue into my next question. The fact that he came in his heaviest for this fight, do you think that that made a difference in his overall performance, where we were used to see him agile and stick and move and be the combination puncher that he was in this fight every last 10 seconds of the round? But do you think that he's finally filled into the division, and that's what had him giving this slower, more methodical heavyweight performance? Opposed to yourself, that you were a lot agile, sticking and moving, using the jab. I mean, I just don't know how you weren't awarded for using the jab as much.
Exactly. That's exactly what I'm saying. It's obvious that the judges and some people aren't used to seeing a jab being used like that. So they don't score it, because it's taboo to them. Oh, he's just jabbing. No. That wasn't just a jab. You see, if I was 203 pounds, 20 pounds lighter than my opponent. He's supposedly the power puncher. Me, I'm supposedly not a power puncher. Why is he not walking me down? You know, why is he not just walking through me? There's some power there. You know, that was a strong jab. But with Adamic and the size thing, this goes to show you guys, like I said earlier, they've been pulling the wool over the fan, over boxing's eyes, saying how fast Adamic is and how he does this. Adamic's been fighting bigger guys. Look, Chris Areola, Michael Grant, all these other guys, they've been solid heavyweights, 220 and above. You know, that's why Nazim wasn't concerned about me coming in extra heavy. Don't come in at 210, Stevie tells me. We want you to come in at a 204, 203, at 205 at the best. And I come in at 203. Why? To keep my speed, to be faster, and to be more agile than this guy. He's been the smaller guy all the time. That's why he's looked like he's been faster and more agile than these guys. But really, he's the same Adamic. He's been the same Adamic. So it's not that Adamic has digressed. It's just, and you see this, the same thing. He looked bad when he fought Eddie, a smaller, faster guy. He looked bad when he fought Chad Dawson, a smaller, faster guy. You know, so it's the thing with Adam, man. When you're smaller and you're faster, he can't touch you. He shouldn't be able to hit you hard enough to get those shots out unless you're banging with him. And that's the mistake I made in the first fight.
Now, after rewatching the tape and, you know, clearly having your blood calm down and watching it with a level mind and noticing all the right hands that landed, was it more absurd to you, the decision? Because you landed quite a few big right hands on him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was absurd. I mean, man, I watched the fight last night. Somebody posted it on my page, and I was just going to watch the NBC. I wanted to see how NBC did it, you know, the intro and the locker room, you know, get that big feel. I just wanted to see how it was, and I'm watching that, and I'm like, man, they did a great job, you know, so... And I'm walking out to the ring. I'm like, all right, I'm just gonna watch it up to the ring walk, and then I'm gonna stop. And then the ring walk was great. Michael Buffer's going in. I'm like, oh man, you know, I'm gonna watch the first round. And and then after that, I'm watching the whole fight, and I'm like, yo, look at that. That's my round. Look at that. That's my round. Look at, you know, I'm just going off, and I'm giving Adamic rounds on just giving him rounds on doubt, maybe. And you can only give him four. You can only give him four, and I'm just like, wow, it's either these judges are scoring shots that I'm blocking, or they're not scoring my jab, or they just don't like me because I'm boxing. I'm doing what the art, what the sport is. I'm boxing. You know, it's one of them things, man. It's like I said, they're either on the tape or they just don't know how to do their job.
Yeah, well, I'll be honest. I gave him one more round than four. I gave him five rounds. I gave him the second round. I gave him the fifth and the sixth, the eighth and the 11th.
Okay.
But every other round, I kind of feel that you won very decisively. There was one round, and I apologize because we were supposed to have you on last week, and I don't know where my notes are. There was one round that was definitely a toss-up, so it still could have been, you know, an 8-4 fight.
Yeah.
I just don't understand with all the right hands. I mean, I heard Nassim Richardson in the corner telling you not to exchange with him, you know. Don't make it a slugfest. But I found that you had a lot of success when you did stand your ground and fight. So well, again, after watching it, did you feel that way as well?
Well, I tell you the thing, Nazim is such a, and I said this to the reporters after, he's a genius. This dude is sick. If you're his fighter and you're fighting Joe Blow, he'll go get fights from Joe Blow from 10 years ago and study them. Watch this guy's habits, and he did that with Tomas. And the thing was, when you exchange with Tomas, his chin is so good. His chin is his defense. He has no defense. His chin, but his chin. When you're hitting his chin, he knows you're right there. And so if you're in there too long, he counters. He punches in between your punches, and that's when he gets you. Same thing with the Travis Walker fight. Travis was launching the right hand. Tomas launched his. Boom, back. And that was it. It's lights out. So the thing was to not trade with him long. I mean, I did my thing, but it was still get back out of there because we know this dude is dangerous. He's he was number four heavyweight in the world. You know, I'm just stepping up to the heavyweights. You got to respect this man. But with all that respect, I still did my job. You know, we went in there, landed that double jab right hand numerous times. He's a sucker for a right hand. I mean, golly, Eddie Chambers with one hand, he's not even a southpaw. Cracked him so much, it's unbelievable, you know?
Well, my last question is, since you mentioned that Nazim studies so much tape, did you guys review the Nagy-Aguilera fight? Because that was a fight where I felt that he did show signs of decreasing as an overall fighter. I mean, he let I don't even want to call him mid-level opposition. I mean, Nagy Aguilera, look, I'm Dominican descent. My parents are both from there, and there would be nothing more that I would want to do than root for a Dominican guy. But,
no doubt.
Man, he comes into the ring overweight and unprepared, and he gave Adamek a hell of a fight on NBC. So I want to know, did you guys use that fight as well to review for training?
I didn't watch fights with Nas. He watched them himself. But he brought up every fight that he watched, and he's saying, if you look at the Aguilera fight, Aguilera was using movement, he was using his jab to get in, and he was boxing, you know, more so than Adamek was. And you know, people say, oh, that's when, you know, that was after the Vitaly fight, and Vitaly did this to him and declined Adamek. No, Aguilera was just boxing, you know what I mean? With his size, he was boxing, and Adamek can't deal with the boxer. If you fight Adamek, he wins the fight. You know, if you box Adamek, he looks like an old man.
I'm going to pass you on to Joe Habib. But, Joe, before I do that, on Twitter, at the Fight Ghost says, one of the judges, his name is Gear, in 20 years of a career had never turned in a 12-round scorecard. Wow. Never should have been doing TV and main events. Yeah. And, you know, it's just – that's basically the overall consensus on all social media platforms, because social media – as you can see, Showtime and HBO, I don't know if NBC has quite implemented it yet, but I know that Main Events, as a promoter, they do involve social media. They use Ustream and things like that for your weigh-ins. And that's basically where all the fans are at this point. Maybe not the casual, but the hardcores, the one that really know the sport. And the overall consensus is that you won this fight. And it's just sad because you've had some, you know, clearly some bad decisions in your career. And, you know, I just want to tell you on my behalf and everyone here on the Boxing Voice, we felt that you won that fight hands down. And I want to pass you on to our other co-host, Joe Habib. Joe.
All right. Steve, it's really no secret you're a boxer. That's your style. But we've seen many times in the past, particularly with Marquez not getting those three decisions against Pacquiao, your style's not always rewarded. Do you get the urge to maybe change your style to please some of these judges like Harold Lettelman, who tends to go for the aggressive guy? Or do you just think that, you know what, I mean, this is the way I fight, and I'm going to keep fighting this way?
Well, I mean, yeah, it's one of those things. This is the way I fight, and I'm going to keep fighting this way, but you still can add, you know? And I believe we've done that with Nazem. We're still adding. I'm 36 years old, but I'm still learning, you know? And that's the good thing. That's gonna prove to help my longevity. With the style thing, it's like, if a guy boxes a guy, does he beat him? Then award him, you know. But of course, we're not in a perfect world, and you know, guys like Letterman, who Adamek is hanging his success on. Well, Letterman scored it for me. He doesn't score around for a guy if he's boxing, if he's using the ring, if he's moving backwards, you know. So that's asinine right there. But you know, I don't. If a guy changes his style, you know, to be more of a puncher, then that guy may most likely get knocked out. You know, that's Waters. I mean, we all punch. I punch. I throw big punches in there, here and there. But I'm, you know, it's a little more. I'm smarter. You know, if I see I get the guy, I'm gonna keep trying. If he's hurt, I'm going for the KO. If not, you know, we're still gonna work to hurt him.
You said that Adamek's so easy to hit, and it was very apparent that you could hit him when you wanted to in this fight because he's so easy to hit. Is it hard to stay disciplined and not slug with him because of that?
Yeah, it is. It was in the first fight. The first fight, you just see me going nuts. You know, I hit this guy with a jab, lead, uppercut. You know, this is unbelievable. It's unheard of. And I'm saying to myself in the fight, wow, I hit him with that, you know, double right hands. It's the first fight shows you where mistakes are, what Adamek's strengths are. His chin is his defense. He can eat those shots. He'll eat those shots, and then boom, he's got you. So with the first fight, the whole training camp was discipline. That was the training camp. Boxing, discipline, boxing. And I believe we did that.
Now, Kathy Duva spoke very highly of you at the post-fight press conference, and everyone was happy with this fight, Steve. I mean, it was a great fight. I can't lie to you. Does that make you feel any better? And based off of that, do you feel confident that you're going to get these fights in the future, more bigger fights, and you think you're not going to have any problems getting fights at this division?
Well, I mean, that's the double-edged sword right there. You know what I mean? fighting is good, and not getting the win, not progressing to where I'm in a position where guys have to fight me. After seeing a performance like that, we've already heard of a couple fighters saying, oh, we won't fight Steve Cunningham, you know? So, you know, that's a double-edged sword. You know, fighting that good and getting cheated puts me here instead of there. So, you know, it's like, well, we don't have to fight Cunningham, we won't. You know, we're not going to go that route. But, you know, what can I do? You know, they say there's no losers in this fight, and I still will progress, so we'll see. You know, I have faith in my promoters, so we'll see.
He still was able to touch a few times, and you just appeared to be able to handle the shots much better this time around than you did in the first fight. Was this more of you just knowing his style better and seeing the shots coming, or did you feel as though maybe his power wasn't the same as it was back then?
No, he still hits hard. You know, when we picked our gloves, you know, he had his Grant gloves, and they seemed a little thinner. You know, I used to love Grant gloves, and those gloves seemed a little thinner than they usually do. So I'm looking at Nas, and he's like, listen, you can pick the same gloves he has. You know, and I'm like, no, I got this deal with Everlast. You know, we got a relationship. I'm going to stick with him. But I'm like, man, these aren't the Grant gloves I used to fight in. And so I'm like, these are puncher's gloves. You know, so, you know, I felt them. You know, he still got that pop. But it's just one of them things, man. I believe, and Nas said it before I went heavyweight, these extra pounds that I put on, he believes will help me from going down off flash knockdowns. Because, I mean, a lot of people don't know, man, I was a very, very small cruiserweight. You know, I'd leave the gym at like 192, you know, 191 after a workout. You know, I never came in over 200, never. I was trying to get to 200 at the weigh-ins, you know, drinking water at the scale. You know, I'd come in at 198, 197. So I think, you know, from all the training, and I worked hard, you know, swim, run, jumping hills. I did all that stuff. I still do, but not as much, trying to hold the weight. And it's like I think I was beating my body up so much. Then I get into the fight, and I get a good shot, get hit with a good shot, I go down. But you see I get right back up. But it's just I think this extra weight has really helped me sustain and eat those shots.
So moving forward, obviously you're going to stay at heavyweight. Should we expect to see you go above 203, 205, or is this the weight that you're going to be at? Do you feel yourself getting bigger in the future, or are you just going to stay where you are?
Yeah, I tell you guys something. I think I mentioned it once to somebody, but and I'm not making any excuses, man. I don't make excuses. The fight happened. I did great, but I just want to tell you guys, I had a stomach virus. You know, 2 days before we came to Bethlehem, my son had it in church that Sunday. He's throwing up in church, and you know how those stomach viruses go. And it went through my wife, and it went through me. And we didn't work out that Tuesday. I rested. Wednesday, Thursday, I felt okay, but I was still, you know, using the bathroom a lot. My weight would have been 207, 208 for the fight, but I was in the bathroom a lot, and with that stomach virus, man, I just came in at 203, and I just, you know, my thing was the night before the fight, you know, my stomach was really bothering me, and I just was like, I didn't want to postpone this fight because I felt adamant was ripe for the picking, and I didn't want anybody else, you know, getting the fruit, you know, so I wanted to go on with the fight, and I, you know, we never said anything. I mean, what's complaining going to do? I fought with the flu in Germany, and I beat the guy. So once you do something like that, a little stomach virus ain't gonna stop me from fighting.
All right, I got one last one before I pass you back to Ness. Gabriel Rosado is another Philly native like yourself. And, yeah. You know, he spoke of Bernard Hopkins, giving him advice, mentoring him. Does Bernard Hopkins give you advice? Does he help you out? Is he one of your mentors, one of the guys that you look for, to counsel with?
Well, I mean, you know, I see Bernard when he's training. Sometimes I go down there and I'll train at the same gym, not train with him. But, you know, now we got the same trainer, so I'll come in a little later. But, you know, seeing Bernard, he's one of those dudes. He'll give you advice if you're not looking for it, you know. He gives you words of wisdom every time, and his respect there. You know, he is a guy to look up to. He's done things that I wish I can do in this sport, you know, and hope to do. And I'm trying to do so. Yeah, you know, no doubt. You know, if he's got something to say, I'm listening. You know, my ears are open, and he's always, you know, Bernard. He always got something to say, but you know, and it's good advice too.
I just have a quick question before we pass you off. Aside, I mean, you know, you can include him, but There's a lot of prospects coming up out of Philly right now. What do you think about the guys like Derek Ennis, who's fighting next weekend, and Gabriel Rosado and Danny and Jamal Davis, I know, is good friends with you, and Brian Jennings, who's in your division. Yeah. Run down of Philly fighters and what you think.
I mean, you got – all right, let me start with Gabe Rosado. Gabe is one of those guys, man. He's like the working man's boxer. You know, I've seen this guy fight at the lowest level of boxing, you know, fighting – you know, in little shows, and a lot of people, a lot of fans, they can see those shows and see the Vegas shows and be like, oh, these guys will never make it there. But yeah. Gabe Rosado worked his way up through the ranks, man, and he went from, you know, an enlisted to an officer. He's fighting for a world title. You know, he worked his way up there. He didn't get no help. You know, he didn't have no special management, no hot promoter to push him. He fought his way to his fight for his title, and you know, I shot him a tweet, told him how much, you know, we respect what he's doing, man. And he's the working man. He's the working class of boxing, man. I hope he, and I pray, and he can be world champion. We got Brian Jennings. Man, this kid, you know, he's fire. He's got fire in him. He's still learning. He's learning on the job. He looks good. He's giving people what they want, these KOs. And I see him holding the belt in the future.
Cool. I think you're completely right. I mean, I've seen Gabe at the Blue Horizon at Bally's, yeah. You know, an 8-round main event, those kind of shows. And Brian, too, he's worked his way up, and he's gone up a little quicker than most, but he's definitely deserved it and put the work in.
Yeah.
I just want to thank you for coming on. I know it took a lot of work between me and Liv trying to get this together, but thank you very much. I'm going to pass you back off to Nestor now and take off.
Yeah, Steve, I'm infamous for saying one last question. So with that being said, one last question. You're signed to Main Events, and you know, you just mentioned all the Philadelphia fighters, but there may come a time when either you're gonna have to get back in the ring with Adamek, who's not from Philly, but you know, boxing has proved to us that it's easier to make a fight in-house. That being said, guys like Brian Jennings or Edin Chambers, they may be tossed around as possible opponents for you. How do you feel of having to face one of your Philadelphia brethren?
I mean, you know, me, Eddie, we sparred a lot. Chaz Witherspoon, we're like sparring partners for each other. I sparred with Brian Jennings once earlier in his career, I think when he was turning pro. But, you know, it's a respect there. It's like a brotherhood there. I'm not saying we would never fight. But we fight for the right reasons, you know what I'm saying? The right amounts. You know, it's one of those things. Chris Bird, I know Chris Bird pretty well. And, you know, as I was climbing the ranks, he was champion, and he was talking about dropping down in weight. And we, you know, our wives know each other, our families know each other. And they're like, man, if you know, we'll set up a fight. We'll fight each other for the title. You know, we all make money. You know, everybody makes money. It's about making money and winning. You know, it'd been, you know, we'd have did it. You know, it'd have been a goofy fight. You know, but we'd have did it. But same thing with Eddie Chambers and Brian Jennings. You know, is put some titles on the line. You know, we'll fight each other, no doubt. Let it be worth our while. You know, we're not gonna get in there and beat each other up for peanuts. You know, that being said, you know, we are fighters, and if it comes up, you know, like I said, man, it's gotta be worth it for us to fight each other. There's so many other heavyweights. We're all from Philly. How come Philly can't just go out and dominate the world, you know? And then we come and meet each other if we ever all have belts or something. You know, that'd be awesome.
Absolutely, and that's understandable. And I want to thank you again for your time and coming here on the Boxing Voice TV and being one of our first guests on this new platform. You've definitely made it exciting. Twitter is definitely out there and giving their opinions on how well it's going. And I want to commend you, man. I hope every fighter that comes on here has such a great office as a background to do their show. I mean, your memorabilia looks great, man. I really like everything I see back there, man. So once again, thank you. And thank your wife for, you know, helping us get this done. And you know, we wish you the best for 2013. We hope to see you back on our television screens, man. You deserve to be on network television.
I appreciate it, man. Thank you, guys, man. No doubt.
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you.
All right, peace.
Well, there you guys have it, man. USS Cunningham. Finally, we got him on, and, you know, it was good, Jackie. It worked. I feel so I feel so happy. I feel so happy that things went good. And we got a lot of live viewers. I see the count there. I'll keep that to myself. But as you can see the smile beep, this means I'm happy and it worked.
I'm happy too. You know, I got to give you a shout out, man. You know, you were really determined to make this thing work. It had some rough edges to it, and you stuck with it. And you know what? We're having a beautiful show right now, and I'm enjoying myself.
Absolutely. But, you know, credit goes to the diva. She put in a lot of work.
Getting Steve.
Exactly. She put in a lot of work, a lot of back and forth communication with Miss Cunningham and Steve himself to make it possible. And, you know, just for everyone who tuned in last week, the biggest problem is, while I don't want to give out the secrets because the competition may steal the format, the biggest problem clearly is the fighter needs to have a capable device. And Google Plus doesn't play well with iPhone. I don't know why. They're just, you know, discriminating on the best phone on the planet, even though Beeb will object to that. But we're going to move on. We should be getting Daquan Arnett. He said he would be free at 8 o'clock. This is really a wing show, so we're just going to continue to wing it. I guess we can switch topics now. John, if you want to...
shout out real quick?
Sure.
If y'all want a USS Cunningham scarf, like this one, they're like $30 on ussapparel.com. They'll hook you up. And it gets to you really quick. I ordered mine like 3 days ago, and we already got it. So.
I got one.
Yeah, everybody in my house has one. So get your scarves.
All right.
That's what's up. You should have tacked that on the wall at the top there.
Well, if you can see my little setup here, because we're in my office / hallway, I'll give you a quick tour of my memorabilia. I don't have another wall. So this is just, I don't know if you can see it all.
Yeah, we can see it.
Here. And then this is, Russell Peltz gave us that Henry Armstrong poster. So we're in my office hallway. If we were in my room, we could. But I just got a new Mike Tyson painting that I'm looking for a place to hang. So.
Cool. So, all right. So let's move back to Jonathan Gonzalez and the fight taking place in Miami. I just want to go back to this fight, not because I'm an over, I don't know, I'm not a big fan of Jonathan Gonzalez. I'm not saying that he's not a good fighter or that I'm not a fan. I'm just saying I'm not going back to the topic because I have this hidden affection for him. I'm going back to the topic because I believe it's Warriors Boxing that is putting on this card, and they've been putting on quite a few cards in the Miami area, and it's good. It's good to see, you know, boxing in Miami. I mean, I wish I was in Miami to see this fight. It's probably going to be outdoors, and it's good to have it in different places than the normal Las Vegas, L.A., and now clearly New York. So I just want to say that to anybody in the Florida area. You know, January 4th, you got a really good fight, undefeated fighter in Rancis Bartholomew, and also Jonathan Gonzalez on the undercard. But everybody has been giving out awards, Beeb. All this time, we've been having the awards discussion and debate, really. And we've been, I guess, misunderstood. There's not really any one award. I guess the only one, if you want to use them as the most validated, would be the Boxing Writers Association Awards. Other than that, could you, I guess, name any other awards that are as noteworthy?
Well, people seem to put an awful lot of stock in the Ring Awards because technically they're the Bible of boxing. But, you know, a lot can be questioned with their rankings and, you know, their decisions and what they think is the best. But, you know, they do have polls a lot, and they do use public opinion a lot when they make their decisions for Fight of the Year or Fighter of the Year, it's things like that. But when you go on their website, like every so often, frequently what they've been doing is they've been having their Event of the Year, Fight of the Year, and they've already been putting that information out there, and they do a lot of polls. So I do think that they use their polls to help make their decision. So I think that one is a good one to go by as well. And I know they have Yahoo Sports as well. You got Kevin Ioli over there. And, you know, he's been around a while, and his opinion's held in high regard, too. But, yeah, I think the Boxing Writers of Association is going to be the tops because those guys are just really, really involved in the sport on a daily basis, and that's what they do for their jobs primarily. So people are going to tend to go with them more than the others.
Yeah, well, I guess we won't know the winners until June, or do we know before the actual ceremony?
Before June?
Yeah, the last ceremony was in June, I believe.
Oh, really?
May. Or May, yeah.
May, I think, because you guys went. I think it was May.
Yeah.
It could be May. It could be May. Well, all right, so we still have to wait almost 5 months to find out who won what?
Yeah, well, I think it's sort of, a mid-year awards, I guess, but I do agree that that's really the only one worth really honoring. Maybe the Ring Magazine, just because it's so highly touted, even though I do think they are incredibly biased, since it is owned by Oscar De La Hoya and, you know, he owns Golden Boy as well. But I think the Boxing Writers Association, I like the Yahoo stuff, but I think the BWAA is really the best one.
I mean, at least with the Ring and with Yahoo, you'll be getting their results quicker than the Boxing Writers of Associated America. So that's one good thing. And I tend to agree with Ring when it comes to the year-end awards. I think this time around, like Marquez, Pacquiao, event of the year, I can go with that. I mean, that's fair. Marquez, Pacquiao, knockout of the year. Those are pretty easy ones, though. But, yeah, I mean,
yeah.
I don't find myself agreeing with Ring a lot when it comes to rankings and stuff like that. But I do like the website. And I don't read the magazine anymore, but I do go to the website quite frequently. And I do like the writers over there. So it'll be nice to see what they think, come January.
I'm going to go with the Boxing Writers Association awards ceremony and awards being the most, I guess, noteworthy, simply because every mainstream website has a writer or an editor on the panel for the Boxing Writers Association. So it's not like just one body decides these things. It's a collective decision between numerous individuals. And because they're not working for their own site, it can't be biased because, again, it must be some sort of voting poll or, I don't know, whatever word Jackie wants to help me out. She's the one with the MBA, PhD, and all that other good stuff. But,
you know,
Diva!
Whatever collective decision method that they choose. So I'm going to go with them. And plus last year's awards, I didn't mind them. Virgil Hunter being trainer of the year last year, I could see it with the things that Andre Ward was able to do. Andre Ward being fighter of the year, I could see it with what he was able to do. While I will not be a hypocrite and say, yet he only fought two times, but I was led to believe by the president of the Boxing Writers Association, which is Jack Hurst, that that decision to give Andre Ward Fighter of the Year was based on a collective two-year, what he'd done in the past 2 years. So that was...
What he's done for boxing, do you think? Sorry to interrupt, but...
Well, I wouldn't necessarily say Andre Ward has done much for boxing at this point. I think it was more like...
Well, that tournament was something that was very, very hard to overlook. And, that 2 year tournament kind of encompassed one accomplishment that could be carried over to that, to the following year, because that's when that tournament ended last year.
Absolutely, and that's what I agree with, but I also agree that the tournament was kind of like Andre Ward's coming out party.
Absolutely.
I mean, he went into the tournament as an underdog and came out of it the top dog. And good for him. Good for him. Unfortunately, he hurt his shoulder or something, and we're not going to see that Kelly Pavlik fight. And we had Kelly Pavlik on our old radio show, and he was very adamant about that fight and very confident, feeling that Andre Ward has never been in the ring with someone with the power that Kelly Pavlik has. And while I give Andre Ward the edge, I'm still very interested in seeing if, that happens and what happens in that fight. But, yeah.
I mean, just to speak on the Andre Ward-Kelly Pavlik fight a little bit, I'm not too sure I was excited about that. I mean, Kelly's not the same Kelly Pavlik, we knew and loved. And even, aside from his personal demons, the drugs and whatever. But I just don't think, you know, I think he would be totally outclassed, totally outboxed, and probably maybe even get really hurt against Andre Ward. John just said in the chat that Ward Pavlik would be no different than Ward Frock, and I totally agree. It would be the Andre Ward show.
I think it would be an easier fight than the Frock fight was, in my opinion. But one interesting thing about Ward is the only fights that really make sense right now at super middleweight are with guys that he already beat, and that's Frotch, a rematch with Frotch and a rematch with Kessler. You know, a lot of the luster off a possible Boutte match has kind of been taken away because of what Frotch did to Boutte. But Frotch and Kessler, they don't seem to be too interested in a rematch with Ward unless Ward fights them in their backyards. They don't feel very keen on coming to the United States to fight Ward. And, you know, they have a point there. I mean, Ward pretty much has gotten his way when it comes to choice of venues, although, you know, the Atlantic City venue was technically a neutral ground. But I would be interested to see Ward go overseas. Obviously, he doesn't really have to do that, but it would add another wrinkle to the event and add another challenge to the event, being, you know, kind of giving it an international flair back to when he was in the Olympics and he had to travel, and back in his amateur days, when he fought, you know, in many different venues and different locations. It would be interesting to see Frotch, Ward go over and fight Frotch in the UK in that big stadium over there. And I think it would draw a lot of people, and I think it would be lucrative for both guys. I think that would be a great match. Great event.
I agree with you, Joe. I was at Ward Frock because it was right down in Boardwalk Hall, and I think anytime I go to a fight in Boardwalk Hall nowadays, when it's in the big room, it's really sad. And I thought for that fight, to see somebody like Andre Ward, for it to be that empty, it was empty. And I remember going there to see Mickey Ward and Arturo Gatti 2 and 3, and then Arturo's little string of fights after that, and it was packed. Like, they added seats, the building was shaking, packed. So I think that for Ward to really be the Ward that we want him to be, he has to kind of stay home, or like you said, go to Europe. It would be a huge draw because he's not pulling people here on the East Coast. Yeah. I mean, to not even fill the you know, the second layer of Boardwalk Hall, that's a little scary. I mean, there must have been, I don't know, maybe 6,000 people there.
And, you know, Frotch has a point. I mean, Frotch can sell out in the UK. He can sell out very easily, where Ward, he can sell out the Oracle Arena, but again, you know, it gives him the advantage that everyone's got to come to California, and eventually people are going to get sick of that. That's going to wear thin, and a lot of guys are going to say, a guy like Frotch, who doesn't have to go to the United States to make a ton of money, he can make a lot of money overseas. You know, he fought Boutte, and that event did very well. They can still fight in Canada and make a lot of money, so for Ward to get that lucrative payday, he may have to go in someone else's backyard.
I agree with you. John in the chat says that Ward Frock 2 is rumored to be in play if Frock beats Kessler. What do we think about Frock's chances of beating Kessler?
I would tend to favor him this time around, and I favored him the first time around, although I did give Kessler the first fight. I thought it was a very close decision. But I think Frotch is maybe the more fresher guy. I think you know, he's been fighting tougher opposition a little bit, and I think that Kessler's coming off the layoff. Although he did fight a few times, he hasn't really fought top level guys. I mean, we all know Green's not the best super middleweight in the world, and I think that fight was at light heavyweight. It was like a catchweight or something. But I just think Frotch is more on top of his game now. I think Kessler's older, starting to wear down a little bit. Although he's still very skilled. I would go with Frotch. I think Frotch would win, and I wouldn't be surprised if the fight wasn't as competitive as the first fight was. I think Frotch is a more confident guy. You know, I think that he knows Kessler very well. I think Frotch could fight a little bit differently. I think Kessler's more of a conventional guy, likes to box on the outside, you know, uses that jab excessively. That's his main weapon. And I think, you know, Frotch can switch it up a little bit. He can get in your chest. He can box a little bit. And he can make the fight ugly when need be. And I just think that there were some factors going into that fight the first time around that kind of distracted Frotch. And I think it won't happen this time. I think under optimum conditions, I think Frotch will beat Kessler, in my opinion.
Well, I just want to you know, go over a message we got 3 minutes ago on the chat. It says Prime Pavlik versus Ward would have been horrible. Pavlik Ward now is terrible unless Ward fought him one-handed. Wow.
Yeah.
Not giving Pavlik any shot. And that's Chris Williams. That's Chris Williams from CB Boxing Info.
Hi, Chrissy. I love Chris.
CB Boxing Info, yeah. Very good guy. Definitely knows his stuff. I sent him an invite in case he wants to come on live and maybe, you know, shoot the shit. Give his own takes here live. John, you want to go ahead and try that one more time? John sent a few messages. He says Ward versus Pavlik would be no different.
I did
to
that
Ward.
Already. I read all John's stuff.
She said that already.
Better. Can you hear me?
We hear you a little better. We'll go ahead and deal with it. Go ahead.
Yeah, well, I've spoken to Eddie.
John, you know what? Do you have an earpiece like the ones used for the iPhone?
Yeah.
Plug that in. That'll probably work.
Okay, give me a minute.
No problem. So, yeah, I know you guys probably were over there cringing like, oh, this guy's interviewing Steve Cunningham, smoking a cigarette. I can't help it. I'm addicted. Like I am addicted to boxing.
It kind of makes you look kind of fly back there, chilling, man, with the cigarette. like, you know what? I'm doing what I want to do. This is my, you know, my thing.
This is my block.
So, all right, on the schedule, January 11th, we're going to have the return of Showbox, and it's going to, you know, face the fighter that I'm trying to get on, and he's really trying, and, you know, big shout-out to Daquan Arnett. I'm actually going to pull up his Twitter. I think all you guys should follow him. This guy is definitely up and coming. He had about 7 fights last year, and, you know, I don't know, if Jackie, if you can help me pull up his box rec and just say how many knockouts he got last year while I go ahead and tell everyone his Twitter, because he's very willing to come on, and he's trying his hardest. And it's at Daquan, DaquanArnett. And he's an Al Haymon fighter. He goes by Mr. Orlando. And like I said, he's trying very hard to get on. He has a tablet. So I don't know if he's trying to make the transition to a computer or not. But it's really the tablet giving him a problem. Unfortunately, Joe, you can't defend him. He has an Android tablet, and it's not working. So I don't get it. But let's see if John sounds any better.
Hey there, can you hear me any better now?
Yeah!
Oh,
my.
You're beautiful. They're beautiful.
There we go. We're going to get there.
Quick before we start talking to John, I looked up Daquan Arnett's box rec. Let me just help me make sure he's 9-0 with 6 knockouts.
That's
him. That's what I'm looking at.
That's him.
He fought in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. He's fought 7 times this year. And all of them were wins by knockout.
And that's something to be impressed about because he was on Showbox. It's not like he fought a bunch of bums either. You know, he's fought some pretty good opposition, especially for a kid with 9 fights. And if you think about it, he had 7 this year. So he had 2 fights the beginning of this year, and he's fought 7 times. And a bunch of those times were on Showbox, so catch him. He's an exciting fighter. I remember the first time seeing him, he was on the undercard of Ishae Smith versus – I forgot that guy. It was live at the Hard Rock Casino, and he looked great. And ever since then, you know, we reached out. Mario made a good relationship with Daquan and his father. And, you know, he's been on the show quite a few times, and we're trying to get him on this new platform because he's the future. And, you know, we feel we're the future of boxing websites and boxing media and things like that. So we want to showcase the new guys as well as the old superstars. But, John, take it away.
Hi there. Well, where do you want to start? Do you want to go back to Gavin Reese, or do you want to go Froch Kessler and Froch Ward?
Oh, I'd love to hear about Gavin Reese.
Yeah, well, I'm interviewing Gavin tomorrow. He's agreed that we're going to get a chat with him tomorrow, and we'll get that written up. But Gavin is a good, honest fighter. He's a come-forward pressure fighter. He's essentially a poor man's Antonio DiMarco. He's going to come forward. He's going to try his hardest, but he's probably going to get stopped eventually.
John, should we expect to see anything different than we saw in Broner's fight against DeMarco? Is Reese going to bring anything different? Is there an extra wrinkle that Reese can bring to this fight to make this fight a little bit more competitive than the DeMarco fight was?
The only thing Reese can do is to apply pressure smarter than DeMarco did. Rather than walking forward in straight lines, he can be more careful with his pressure, work the body more, do his work and try and get out. Because due to Gavin's size, he's a small lightweight. He isn't able to box from the outside. He's going to have to try and get inside. So it's probably going to have a very similar outcome to Broner DeMarco, but there is small changes that Gavin can do to maybe help him last longer.
Now, has Gavin faced anyone on this level? And if not, how many levels under a Broner has his competition been?
Gavin is actually a former world champion at light welterweight. He was a couple of years ago. Again, he hasn't fought anyone anywhere close to Broner's level, but he has fought a couple of good guys. 2 seconds, so I'll just pull up his record to confirm. But he's had some solid wins this year over good domestic fighters, but there's been no one of note for a wee while. I'm just waiting for my tablet to load so I can confirm which fights he had as a world champion. He was the WBA belt holder a couple of years ago.
Who else?
Gavin Reese.
Okay.
Yeah, Kotelnik's the best he's faced.
And did he win that fight?
He got stopped in the 12th.
By Kotelnik?
By Kotelnik.
Holy Jesus. Wow. I mean, listen, I know Kotelnik's good. He did a good job versus Alexander. He beat Maidana. And I'm just saying, I didn't know he had the power to stop anyone.
Gavin was horribly unfit at that time. He used to fight at light welterweight, and that was only because he didn't like training. He was a very good fighter for the first half of a fight, and then he would tire horribly. Since then, he's switched trainers. He's now with a guy called Gary Lockett. He's dropped down to 135, and he's a much better fighter, and he's in much better shape as a result.
So tell us about, you mentioned Frotch.
Yeah, Frotch Kessler 2 is almost a done deal. We're going to be seeing that in an open-air stadium, most likely Wembley, the National Soccer Stadium, in March.
Wow. John, do you think the change of venues will kind of light a fire under Frotch? You think it'll be an extra advantage for him going into this fight? And do you think this fight's going to be as competitive as the first fight was? Because I have a sense that maybe Frotch could win this fight a lot more convincingly convincingly than people will think.
Yeah, I personally think Frotch is going to look very good in this fight. Kessler's had a lot of wear and tear, and I know Carl Frotch has had a very tough run-in, but he hasn't been in any out-and-out wars. So I expect Frotch, with the home support, to get him fired up the way that they did with Beauty. It all depends on how Kessler wants to fight him. If Kessler wants to stand and trade and get involved, then it's going to be Frotch probably stops him mid to late. If Kessler decides to try and box on the outside for as long as possible, then it could be a close decision.
Well, let me ask you this, John. What happened with that rematch clause with Boutte? Is that out the window now? Is that something that Boutte didn't want? Or what's going on with that?
Having spoken to Eddie, they've come to an agreement with Lucien's team that Lucien will step aside to allow this fight to happen, to allow Beauty to have another tune-up fight, and afterwards, if Beauty does want it, he will have the opportunity to fight the winner.
They don't sound very confident that they would do well with Frotch in a rematch, or that they even want the fight. Do you get the sense that Boutte is really looking to get a few more soft touches, he and his team, or do you just think that he's just not ready right now?
Beauty will take a few more soft touches because the Grachev fight showed that he can be hurt still. If you put pressure on him, he's going to be in trouble. I think Beauty will take a couple of soft fights and end up facing Adonis Stevenson or John Pascal in one final buyout fight in Canada, which will sell out.
So you think this is probably the end of Beauty? I know it sounds kind of funny to say that right now, since he's really not that old and he should be in the prime of his career, but do you think that knockout really really changed him as a fighter, and then that this is what we have. He's not going to be that same guy that he once was before.
I don't think it changed him as a fighter. I think it more exposed him as a fighter. We'd seen before that he could be hurt, and he was saved in the Andrade fight by bad refereeing. But now the secret's out there. If you pressure him, he's going to crumble. And his defenses, when he was the champion before, were all relatively soft. It's going to be difficult for him to return to the elite level without doing an in-house fight in Canada with either Pascal or Stevenson.
You know, I'm actually happy to see Boutte take a step back and not try to get back in there with Frotch. I mean, while Gravich is a tough guy, and he took out a tough guy in Ishmael Salak and made a name for himself, I really don't see Gravich as that sort of he's not on a Frotch level. He's just not. He doesn't have the experience.
Not close.
he may have the thudding power, but he's not on that level. He hasn't faced that experience, and Boutte needs a few more fights.
Yeah, I agree entirely.
How do those people look right now, the ones that said that Boutte would beat Ward? Remember that way back when, last year or so? Everyone was like, yeah, Boutte's going to beat Ward. Boutte can beat Ward. He can hit harder than Ward. Ward can't hurt him. Ward's not a big puncher. But again,
you know, Beeb, I was one of those guys that really thought that Boutte would present some problems. I mean, I always felt like the chin was going to be basically the Achilles heel if the Andrade fight wasn't a fluke. But if he was able to present or show a solid chin, I thought that his style, his slickness, I mean, Boutte seemed like a black fighter in a white man's body. And then that didn't happen. He wasn't able to show his slickness in the ring. I mean, it felt like he was very scared and overwhelmed in that Frotch fight. And, yeah, he just needs to take it slow. But is that really the key, B? Because, I mean, they took it slow to get him to that point anyway. So is that going to help again?
Well, my question to John was, and I think he pretty much answered it, basically is this it? Is this, you know, what you see is what you get? Maybe this is all that you're going to see from Boutte. Maybe this is just how good he is. We questioned him before. Maybe he's just a good fighter. He's never going to be a great fighter. You know, and that's just, we have to face the reality with that.
Good point. Definitely good point.
But one thing I just didn't like about him was I always felt as though he was a little bit jittery in there. He's, you know, when things were going his way, he looked very fluid. But at certain times when guys did press him, like even in the Andrade fight, you know, and it was, you know, reinforced in the Frotch fight, you know, guys got close to him. He would always have that way, like, I got to get, like, jump back. Like, he just couldn't stay in the pocket with certain guys. And even in the Miranda fight, it just looked like he would just have that little nervousness about him where he'd always had to jump back. And with Ward and his foot speed, I don't think he'd be allowed to jump back. I think Ward would just be in his chest. He'd be cutting the ring off, cutting off that space. And even with Frotch isn't the fastest guy with his hands, but he has deceptively quick feet. I mean, he knows how to cut the ring off on a lot of guys. And you saw he was able to get close to Ward. It's just that in close quarters, Ward's hands were so much quicker that he would get there first. And that's where I think he has the advantage in the Kessler fight, where he could just kind of get deep into the pocket, move his hands, and just shorten up the shots a little bit better than Kessler can. But that was the one weakness I saw with Boutte. I just thought that if you got in his chest a little bit, kind of made him fight a little bit on the pocket or touched him while you know, get in the pocket and touch him up. I just thought that he wouldn't be able to hang with guys at close range.
Yeah, I don't know, man. I like Boutte. I like to see him again and see what he can do. But at this point, who do you match him with in the super middleweight division that he can beat on that level? Could he even beat a Pavlik at this point? And should that be the fight that he goes for since Ward can't take it?
You know, that's a very interesting fight, him versus Pavlik. Because, again, but you know, one thing about Pavlik, he's a guy that fights on the outside, and he'll probably give Boutte some of that space that he needs to be effective. Will he change his game up a little bit under Robert Garcia? Will he try to get inside and throw some body shots, throw short hooks. Right now, honestly, you could say it's maybe a 50-50 fight, or maybe even a slight edge to Bute, but you know, Pavlik is such a heavy hitter that you get the sense that he could hit Bute with one shot and kind of make him crumble. And if he's able to land that one big right hand one time, that could be enough to really put Bute on the defensive and kind of freeze him up a little bit and start the beginning of the end.
Yeah. So, Jackie, any thoughts? How do you think Pavlik versus Bute would look?
Honestly, I think Kelly should hang him up. I don't see him looking good ever again. I think Bute would just, you know, be too big, too strong for him. And maybe too much of a brawler than Kelly can handle right now.
I don't know. I think Pavlik actually has a great shot based on his power, based on the fact that with Robert Garcia, he's been able to improve and add to his game a very dangerous left hook that can probably, you know, take the blinders off the horse and allow Bute to focus more on the left hook and then get stunned by that right hand. And again, you know, this guy's chin is so suspect. We just don't know what Bute we're going to get. We don't know if he'd be able to hang with Pavlik and that right-hand power.
I know, I agree with you. You bring up a good point in his new trainer, Robert Garcia, bringing out kind of the left hook. And you're right, he might go in there and stun him and, you know, work a counterpunch a little bit. But really, I hate to say it, because at one point I really did enjoy Kelly Pavlik. I really did. But what I've seen lately, you know, on his comeback tour, I don't really see it. And, you know, everybody says, oh, well, you know, he got rid of that Rosinski kid and whatever. I saw Will Rosinski a couple days ago, no, about a week ago, at Roseland Ballroom. He looked awful against a kid that he should have looked like Sugar Ray Robinson against. And so that kind of, like, depreciated my value in Kelly Pavlik as well, because if you took that kid out and the kid looked that bad, then, you know, what's he really all about anymore?
I mean, to Brzezinski's credit, he is a full-time EMT.
I totally understand that, and he lives in Queens, and with Sandy, we know what he went through, and we probably wasn't able to train like he should. I'm not discrediting him, you know, for doing his job, because Queens got hit really hard. But
No, and nor am I trying to implicate that you are. I just want to let the casual fans out there that may not know or Will Brzezinski know that he's a full-time EMT that works like the graveyard shift in this ambulance. So, you know, he's got to go home, get sleep, wake up, hit the gym, then hit work again, and sleep basically when you're at work. Yeah. So that makes it, I guess, tougher, because like Floyd trains at the hours of his so-called fight. Rosinski's training at the hours of everyone's sleep.
Right.
And it probably is not working well for him, because I find it strange. I mean, I didn't see that fight. We weren't able to catch it on TV clearly because it was a Broadway boxing. You were there live covering it for the Boxing Voice. But it's weird that you say he looked so bad, because I think he looked really good in the Pavlik fight. What about you,
Ben? No, I'm not saying he looked bad in the Pavlik fight.
No. Like, I know that you're not saying that. What I'm saying is, for him to fight a level of a Pavlik and look decent, and then fight a guy who you feel he should have dominated and look bad. Right. It's weird for me. Like, how did he drop that far? Because he also looked good in the, not good, but didn't he fight Edwin Rodriguez too?
Oh yeah, I was just gonna bring that up. I mean, I thought he was very competitive in that fight. That fight was pretty close.
Yeah.
You know what? I have to kind of backtrack myself, because now that you reminded me he's an EMT, his neighborhood, we have to step back and look at what especially his neighborhood has been going through the past 6 weeks. I know in my town, I still have detours from the hurricane. So his neighborhood, where there were sections of it that were completely burned down, being an EMT there, I'm not sure he was able to train 110% like he might have for Rodriguez or Pavlik or something like that. You know, Breezy Point, Queens doesn't exist anymore.
Well, that just makes you wonder, though, if he was able to train full-time, how
that, good that's what I'm saying. So maybe I'll retract my opinion. Which doesn't happen often, but I didn't consider that.
I want to make one more point about Boutte. I hate to switch the topic a little bit, but going back to that nervousness and that nervous energy that he fights with, because of that nervousness, I think he just expends a lot of energy, depletes a lot of adrenaline, and that's why I think he fatigues. Oscar De La Hoya was one of those guys who kind of fought with a clenched fist, always a bundle of adrenaline, you know what I mean? Yeah. And those types of guys...
wound up.
Yeah, they're just wound up too tight, and that's a mental thing, and that's something he's going to have to work out. Because if you look at some of these guys like Frotch and Ward and Kessler, they just, you can tell that they're seasoned. They obviously, I'm sure they must get nervous in there, but they can really control their emotions and really kind of implement the game plan. Whereas this guy seems as though if he's not able to have things go his way, he looks a little bit flustered in there to me.
Yeah.
So our friend here on Google and in the boxing world, Chris Williams, asked if we were going to do a 2012 year-round recap. I don't know. What do you think, Beeb? What do you think that consists of? I mean, clearly it consists of the entire year. But recap it in which way do you think he's imagining?
I mean, it's a great idea, but it seems as though these last couple of shows we've kind of been doing that to some degree. We could probably, this is the last show of the year, am I not mistaken? Yeah, this is the last show of the year, and we kind of are going over a lot of the fight of the year. We talked about fighter of the year in the show before this, so we've kind of been doing that. So I don't know, maybe in our next show we could do a formal one. It's not a bad idea, and we could just kind of reiterate a lot of our original points, and hopefully we can have more people call in, more people join in in the chat, and have a bigger discussion on it, but it's not a bad idea.
I agree with Joe. I mean, I think let's give ourselves some time to each take our own notes, you know, organize it, and we can recap absolutely everything, but I do think we've been discussing it pretty heavily the past couple shows, couple weeks.
Yeah. But again, I mean, if people have any questions, I mean, they're free to put them in the chat. Or if they have any topics that they want us to talk about, I'm sure they can just put them in the chat, and we'll bring them up.
Absolutely. Well, one thing that we need to talk about was the fact that yesterday they did play Mike Alvarado, Brandon Rios. Anyone catch that replay of what a lot of people are picking over the Marquez Pacquiao fight for fight of the year? After watching it again, for those of you on the panel that have watched it again, how was it?
I'm going to go right ahead and say that Pacquiao Marquez does not deserve to be fight of the year in any which way.
Wow.
Knockout of the year, yes. Event of the year, yes. But fight of the year, come on. Let's be real.
Woo! Go, Jackie!
Rios Alvarado, as my dad says, if you guys like listen to the old show when my dad was on or have ever sat and watched a fight with my dad, he tells you that boxing fans put up with a lot of bullshit with Cunningham decisions and Tim Bradley decisions and this, that, and the other. It's a lot of bullshit, but every once in a while, something special happens, and that's what pulls us back in and keeps us loyal to boxing. Rios Alvarado, for me, was one of those. It was probably fight of the year. I'm going to say fight of maybe the past 2 years. We've been watching it kind of like on a loop because it's on demand on Fios. Like, I was cooking dinner. I put it on the kitchen the other day. Like, we've just been watching it over and over, and I can watch it and see something new every time. And for me, that's what makes it fight of the year special. It's...
Wait. You said you can watch it and see something new every time?
Yeah, I mean, because if I'm cooking dinner, I'm not paying attention 100%. That if I'm folding clothes, so when I watch it, I get something different from it.
Away from it. She could take something different away from it each time she watches it, which is understandable. I mean, because you tend to look for certain things when you're watching it. Like, one time you may be looking for like who won the close rounds. Another time you can just be watching it for entertainment purposes.
Exactly.
Another time you could be looking for that one big punch that turned the fight. So there are a lot of aspects.
Yeah, to you can watch every fight six times and take something different away from
Absolutely.
It.
Absolutely, I totally agree.
You know what I took away from it yesterday was the fact that Brandon Reels was able to land so many left hooks from so many awkward positions.
Yes.
Beeb, you're a guy that you've always given him a lot of credit. I remember, you know, your many times on when you used to be with Rope-A-Dope mentioned how much of an underrated boxer he was. Yeah. And yesterday, I seen that, and you stuck out in my mind because I noticed that he would move and give angles, and while he wouldn't turn Alvarado, he would turn himself where the left hook would be landing like this on Alvarado's face this way, but his body would be like, you know, his chest would be on one of Alvarado's, probably Alvarado's left shoulder. He would be in such awkward positions and bring that left hook from basically anywhere, and he did a lot of damage with that left hook, man. And what I also seen was that as much as people want to argue and debate that Alvarado was able to hurt Reels, I didn't see it. After watching it again, I didn't see it. I would see Alvarado come on and land and throw nice-looking combinations, but they just wouldn't really do anything.
Well, when you see Alvarado land the punches and you see Reels kind of roll with them, he rolls with them, but in the same regard, he takes a little bit of the brunt of them too. He doesn't fully roll the punch. But with all that being said, he still walks through the shot. So it looks like it's doing more damage than what it really is. But going back to Reels and his underrated technical skills, another thing about Reels, too, is he's just able to change the trajectory of his punches. Like, you can give him, like, that little bit of a space, and he'll be able to just, like, turn over a short right hand. Same thing with the hook, you know. He can position his body where he can hit you and you can't hit him. And he can just put shots together and set shots up very well. And if you watch him, when he throws punches, he doesn't waste many punches. He'll throw a body shot, and right behind it, he'll either hook back to the head or he'll come up with a right uppercut. So he's constantly, you know, touching you and trying to open you up. And when you hear a guy say, "Oh, well, he wasn't aggressive against me, so I really couldn't get my offense going. The guy was running from me." Reels doesn't allow you to run from him. Reels doesn't allow you to shell up against him. He'll find a way to open you up and pressure you and cut the ring off where there's nowhere to go. And that's
Richard Abreu.
Yeah, that was a bad performance. That was a very bad performance. And I'm actually gonna do something I never really do. I'm gonna give him a pass on that fight because he looked dead in there to me. I really attribute most of that to the conditioning. I think at 140 pounds, I honestly can say that Reels should probably eat him up, in my opinion. And that's taking nothing away from Abreu. But I just seen, when I go back to the Miguel Acosta fight, that was when Reels first started having problems with the weight. But again, you know, he was able to cut the ring off. He was able to really shorten up some of the shots on the inside. And he's another guy who's very underrated with foot speed. He's very quick on his feet. He's very explosive on his feet. So yeah, I agree with you. Yeah, I mean, you could point to that Abreu fight and just say, "Hey, you know what? This was a fight where he looked like he had no answers." But that was a time where, you know, a point in his career where, you know, it was just enough. He couldn't make that 135 anymore. I mean, he really didn't even want to take that fight. He was basically forced into taking it. But you know, it happened, and you can legitimately point to that, and that's a good point. It's definitely a good point. But I don't think you'll see too many fights like that from, you know, Reels in the future. I think you'll see him improving, and I think you'll see a much more dominant Reels than you did in that fight.
We'll see the true Brandon Reels. Well, we'll find out if the Abreu fight was nothing more than an off night when he was drained, killed, making the weight, or is Richard Abril's style his kryptonite. We will find out next time he faces an awkward, tall, rangy fighter.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, you know, I'm not going to give him a pass. I actually feel that he should give Abreu a rematch.
He should.
I think that it's not that that Abreu deserves a rematch. I think that Brandon Reel deserves it. I think Brandon Reel owes it to his fans to prove that was a fluke. I mean, to take it on the chin as if you beat him when so many people know that that's not true. It has me feel like he's afraid of that style, Beeb. Like,
I think you're correct, Nestor, and I should rephrase what I just said. I think I misspoke there. We shouldn't really give him a pass because he lost the fight. But I believe he's a much better fighter than what he showed on that night. So that's what I'm trying to say. That's my point.
And I agree with you, but don't you think he should prove that to his fans? Because let's be honest, the Rios fans, they love this guy. And I love him too, but they love him like to the fact where they're almost blind. And they're like, no, he beat Rios. Oh, Rios was holding. Like, they'll make excuses. And is that enough? Should that be enough for Brandon Rios himself? Or should he get back in the ring with this guy and prove it?
Well, it's Jackie, I'm sorry.
I think you should get back in because for his own sake, to prove to his fans that, yes, I can beat this guy and it was the way or whatever, but how about you give Abril a shot to actually legitimately, on paper, win the fight?
Yeah.
Off night or not, weight drained or not, Richard Abril tagged Brandon Rios like new clothes.
Richard Abril is better than most of us thought he was.
Wait, hey. Can you go back to the old radio show and who called that fight for Richard Abril? Who said
you did? You did. And you know what, Jackie? One other thing. If Gavin Reeves doesn't take this fight or anything happens and it doesn't go down, Richard Abril is the backup plan.
Well, then and, let's see it.
And what? That's gonna
nice.
Yes.
Richard Abril is no longer the backup plan.
John, you're killing me.
Now that Gavin has accepted the shot at Broner, it means that Abril is now free to contest the vacant lightweight title, WBA title, against Bogarty. So he is holding off now because before Gavin Reese was number two in the WBA ratings, Abril was number one, and due to WBA rules, a vacant title can only be contested between the top two available contenders, and Reese was standing in the way of that. Now that Reese takes the Broner fight, it's opened the door for the Abril Bogarty for the WBA belt, and Richard Abril has said he is no longer waiting in the wings.
Okay.
And that's understandable, but what I'm saying, if for whatever reason Gavin Reese pulls out, he gets hurt, I'm pretty sure Abril's going to take the money over the belt.
Yeah, probably. I agree with you.
Well, and then it's another belt. It's a WBC belt. So
yeah, you know.
Yeah.
And a main stage. He'll be on HBO because there's no doubt and no way HBO is going to lose Adrian Broner to Showtime at this point.
But I have a quick question for John. Has that fight been negotiated, Bogarty versus Abril, yet? Or is that something that's still being talked about?
It was negotiated for last year, and then Bogarty pulled out through illness. So I'm guessing negotiations will be pretty simple to get done again because it was going to be for the interim belt because Reese was refusing to step aside previously.
So should we expect to see that fight maybe in February or maybe March at the latest?
Yeah, that fight's going to be early next year, almost certainly.
Okay.
John's our new stats man over here.
John's on point, man. I got to use John as my new resource for info now.
Can I just go back to Rios Alvarado for a minute?
Absolutely.
One of the things I liked so much about it was that, you know, it was a fight everybody kind of wanted to see. Everybody was saying, wouldn't it be great if these two guys fought? And they did. And it seems like more often than not, and too often than it should be, these fights happen, and a lot of us are left like, why is that happening, or what's going on? And I think
and don't allow me to have you lose your point, but let's be honest, it's not a fight we all wanted to see. It's a fight that we made in our fantasy boxing minds because we knew Bob Arum wouldn't allow any of those two fighters to cross over the water to fight a Golden Boy fighter, so... So it was like the slim pickings in the division that can fight each other. So it's like, oh, yeah, that's a good fight. But, you know, everybody would have loved to see Rios versus Khan, Rios versus Peterson, Rios versus
Danny
Garcia.
But again, though, let's look at one point. This fight between Rios and Alvarado had the recipe for excitement. There was no way. There was no way this fight was going to be boring. It was every bit of what we thought it would be.
When this fight was announced, we were all excited. Is my point. Based off of that. We didn't say, "Oh, I wish it could be Khan." We were like, "Yes."
Yeah, no, we were all excited. We were all excited, but I don't like that they tried to sell it as Gotti Ward on HBO either. I mean,
oh, I don't like that either because I think personally, I mean, look behind me.
But you know what? You know what? I guess I can't even say that because
it was Gotti Ward-esque, though. I'll give it that.
Because
it had a lot of similarities, though. We gotta admit that.
Yeah, because you know, I was trying to discredit it because of Alvarado's resume, but then again, Gotti nor Ward had the best resumes either. I guess it was. I mean, you know, it is what it is, but I'm really tired of boxing and the whole Cold War. We got 4 minutes left. We're gonna keep it down to 2 hours since we couldn't get that last guest on. But I just really wish Bob Arum, De La Hoya, Schaefer, all these guys come up with a solution.
I wish Bob Arum my voicemails that I leave him every single day. Every day at 2 p.m. Eastern time, I leave Bob Arum a voicemail.
Hey, you know, one day he'll pick up. He's going to answer he's probably gonna answer and curse you out, but at least you'll get him.
He's usually good about picking up the phone, though. I'm surprised he's like,
who the hell is this? Boxing diva who? You know, so... I mean, at least we got over the hump, guys. We got over the hump, and we got our first guest on here. Once again, thanks to, Boxing Diva, Miss Cunningham, and, of course, Steve Cunningham himself for coming on. We're going to try and stick to this platform, guys. I've been getting messages. I know you guys want to call in. Beeb is working on it. So that guy down there with the gray shirt, he's working on being able to put some sort of a live phone so that we can still interact the way we used to on the radio show. But I implore you guys to make an account on Google Plus, and you can jump on. I mean, you know, I hope you look okay so people don't, you know, talk about how ugly you are.
Yeah, don't look like I did tonight.
Just make sure you wash your face before you come on and everything, you know.
Yeah.
Be presentable. No, I'm just playing.
So, John, any other news that you want to let us know from across the pond?
No, not particularly. The only thing is we do have 5 world title fights that are going to be contested tomorrow morning in Japan.
Okay.
Oh, that's interesting.
Hey, John, actually, I have something to ask. Have you ever made contact with Martin Murray to see if we can get him on? I mean, he's coming into a pretty big fight, and it'll be good to have Martin Murray on a show like this from all the way across the pond live on TV so that everyone can see him.
I'm still working on that at the moment. What I'm thinking is that it's probably going to be easier closer to the fight when he's in South America due to time zones.
All right. And, if you ever want to... Well, I guess it's late for you over there. What time is it for you over there right now?
2 a.m.
Oh, geez.
Yeah, I guess we'll have to do a pre-recorded one like this next time you're in Kell Brook's gym. I know the fans go crazy for that guy, so maybe you could get him to sit down one day at the gym. But yeah. I will be bringing you guys some live footage from Gabriel Rosado next Saturday. I got my date with Rosado and Billy Briscoe. I'll be in the gym and get some...
Hey, why wasn't I invited?
Well, you're more, you know, you're more than welcome to take that ride with me. But yeah, it's going to be next Saturday, and I'm going to try and get as much footage as possible and put together a nice style documentary. I don't want to just do it regular video style, like, the 100+ videos that we have on this channel. But yeah, we're going to see how Gabe's looking, man. He's coming into that big fight with Golovkin, and that's, woo, man, it's almost 2 weeks away, closer to 3 weeks, but, you know, it's a tough one, and I hope he pulls it out, man. I hope he pulls it out and makes Mario look really cheesy. But it's 9 o'clock, guys. This is The Boxing Voice. I am your host, Ness GTO. Follow me right here. See that little thing right there? Wait. Right there. You can follow me there. As you can see, the Diva has her Twitter up.
I have
up.
Him too. Right there.
And Beeb doesn't have his up, but his name is J.H. Habib 1. Right? No, no. J. Habib 1.
J.H.A.B.E.E.B. and the number 1.
And John McDonald, go ahead and give out yours.
J.A.M.A.C.D. 2011.
And as always, you can follow the Boxing Voice right there. And this has been our show, guys. We hope you enjoyed it. Please leave any comments. Email us, Twitter us, DM us, Facebook us, whatever. Please allow us the opportunity to correct anything that you feel is wrong, or give us your opinions. Let us know what would you like to hear on next show, or who you would possibly want. Once again, the guests must have a computer. Clearly, even Android tablets are not working because the Corner Net really tried. And so did who's our favorite caller, man? He tried, and he has an Android running ice cream, The Dream. The Dream has the new ice cream sandwich, whatever you guys call it.
Jelly Bean's the new update.
Oh, Mr. Droid himself. He said he updated to the ice cream, and him and I were able to do a hangout, but it wasn't live, so clearly his software update didn't allow him to do a live hangout. But plenty of fights coming up, new year right around the corner, and we'll be back to our boxing schedule as normal, and we're going to keep bringing you the best interviews possible on this new platform. So we will be seeing more fighters live here on The Boxing Voice, and this has been the show. Thank you again. See you guys Thursday night.
See you next year.
7 p.m.
See you next year.
All right.
Bye.
We're out of here.